I've got to say the crowd has even grown before the start of this MotoGP race. That's very, very encouraging indeed. I'm sure you can hear them all around me. Great encouragement for Valentino Rossi. He's got his hands full this afternoon. MotoGP in Turkey for the first time, and it's an all Honda front row. And Sete Gibernau just arriving in pole position.
Yeah, a lot of expectation around this race, and the dignitaries down there on the grid as well, welcoming MotoGP to Turkey for the first time in its history. It's the 29th country to host a Grand Prix since its inception, of course, at the Isle of Man TT back in 1949. When Nick Harris was commentating trackside.
I thought you were talking about dignitaries. I thought you were going to say I was one of those dignitaries, but there you go. Perhaps I'm not, but yeah, I nearly was trying to commentate trackside at the TT racing. I tell you, if you can imagine it anywhere more different to the TT racing circuit, the mountain circuit on the Isle of Man, than this circuit here in Turkey, it really, you just couldn't. You just couldn't facility-wise and everything else.
It's come a long way in 56 years, hasn't it, MotoGP? It's come a long way in 5 years, going back to the change from 500cc bikes to four strokes. It's really taken the championship onto a new level. No doubt that Valentino Rossi and Sete Gibernau have played a huge part in that. And Gibernau, here he is on pole position and looking for his first victory of 2005.
Yeah, I think Grand Prix racing has made absolutely enormous strides, hasn't it? And you just stand here right on the front row of the grid and look up the main straight here at this superb facility and just everything else about it, and you think, yeah, it's on the right track. There's ups and downs all the time. You get your prophets of doom. They will always tell you that things are going wrong and everything else, but it's very much on the right track. And I think we'll see this afternoon a race prove to us that what the sort of track it's on. I've just got Pete Benson here now. We can have a quick word with him. He's Nicky Hayden's crew chief. Conditions just about perfect, Pete.
Yeah, it's looking really good. It's another nice day and not too windy, so it should be good.
And Nicky said he wanted to do a few things in the warm-up. He wasn't 100% happy with qualifying. Did you manage to do that?
I hope so. We made a couple of changes this morning before the warm-up and a couple of little ones now, so hopefully we'll be a little bit close to these other two guys because they've been fast all weekend.
And an all-Honda front row.
Yeah, that's something new, and it's not often you see the other guys behind us, but I hope we can keep it up.
Pete, thank you very much.
No worries, thanks.
Pete Benson, their chief mechanic, to Nicky Hayden, and by the other guys, of course, he's referring to Valentino Rossi specifically, who will start from behind Nicky Hayden on the grid today in fourth place. Pete Benson also adding there that those two guys, Melandri and Gibernau, have been very, very quick all weekend, but Rossi was quick in the warm-up this morning as well. The warm-up classification was Gibernau from Rossi, Hayden and Melandri. They seem to be the four men with the pace. And as we've seen from Nicky Hayden in recent weeks, particularly at Phillip Island a week ago and in Qatar the week before that, he was really able to pull something extra out for the race. And even in some cases, well, particularly in Qatar, actually lapped faster in the race than he had done in qualifying. So he needs to take a similar sort of step today if he's going to challenge Melandri and Gibernau. You certainly wouldn't bet against Valentino Rossi doing that, but Nicky Hayden also needs to step his game up as well here. And, well, let's hope he can.
It's going to be very interesting indeed. Just alongside Chris Vermeulen, I don't know if I can just get a quick word with Chris. You're on the grid here, Chris. This is what it's all about, MotoGP, isn't it?
No, it is pretty cool. You know, there's a lot of famous guys here, and I'm just happy to be part of it, you know, and it's a great experience for me and having a lot of fun.
And things have gone better and better for you as the weekend's progressed.
They have. Qualified 11th, start of the weekend, I was 14th or 15th, so if we can keep improving, it'll be good, but my goal is top 10, and we'll see how we go.
Chris, thanks a lot, and good luck.
Thank you very much.
Chris Vermeulen there, making his second MotoGP appearance after his debut at Phillip Island a week ago, and Vermeulen there riding for Camel Honda this weekend, but seeming all set to sign on the dotted line with Suzuki, perhaps even before the end of this weekend, to ride as teammate to John Hopkins in 2006.
Yeah, it's going to be a very interesting combination. I think the deal is done and dusted, and I just think a little bit of politics mean that Suzuki can't actually announce that is the situation at the moment. But Chris Vermeulen could have stayed with Honda, and I think they wanted him to, one would imagine, win the World Superbike Championship, but that hasn't turned out to be the case. He wants to get into MotoGP. Mick Doohan, I think, said last week in Australia, get into MotoGP as quick as you can. That's exactly what he's doing. And with Suzuki, with John Hopkins, that's going to be very, very interesting indeed. And he certainly looks really chuffed just sitting on the bike looking up the grid.
Just to interrupt you there, Nick, just getting a look there at Colin Edwards having a deep discussion with the Michelin technicians. We've also seen Sete Gibernau make a late change to his front tyre as well. So it seems that a few last-minute decisions are being made down there about front tyre usage. We heard from Casey Stoner at the end of the 250cc race that his the right-hand side of his front tyre was completely shot by the end of the race. Let's not forget, not many of these riders have had chance to run a full race distance on tyres here this weekend, and it seems as though a few last-minute changes are being made down there.
Yeah, it certainly does. They certainly have changed the front tyre of Sete Gibernau. Both Casey Stoner in particular said that they'd lost a lot of left side of the front tyre during the early stages, right from the early stages of the 250cc race, so that's going to be interesting indeed. And Colin also does appear made a late change as well, so let's see. It's quite strange here. Actually, on the start and finish line, you're actually in the shade. It's only when you get out on the circuit you're actually in the sun. So the tyre technicians don't take the temperature from the track here. They have to go into pit lane to do it because that's where they're out in the sunshine.
Yeah, you can see the big shadow actually that's cast over the grid from this enormous grandstand here that I'm sat actually at the top of here. I had to fight my way up here. The lift was broken on the way up, so...
You had a few words with the gentleman at the bottom, didn't you?
Yeah, I wouldn't like to repeat what they were, but yeah. Made my way up here, managed to make it anyway, and great view over the track.
Sorry to butt in, just get a quick word with Davide Brivio, of course the team manager for Yamaha. Well, quite unusual, Davide, an all Yamaha second row, but the warm-up this morning probably showed it maybe a bit different.
Yeah, definitely this morning of a few problems that we had yesterday. We did one step in yesterday afternoon, but this morning even better. So he had quite a good few laps. So I think we can race now with Valentino.
What a great circuit to race on.
Yeah, the circuit is great. And the first time here, but it has up and down. It's very, very interesting. And so far we have seen 1-5 and 2-50. With big battle, I expect maybe 4 or 5 riders in MotoGP fighting until the end. So let's hope it's a good show.
Let's hope so. Thank you very much.
Okay, ciao, bye.
Davide Brivio there, team director for Gauloises Yamaha. It's been quite a season for Brivio and his men. They've won the Riders World Championship, they've won the Teams World Championship, they've won the Constructors World Championship, and now they come through and finish runner-up to Valentino Rossi. That would make it a total and utter clean sweep for them. But Edwards has got his work cut out. He starts from the second row of the grid and he's got to beat Melandri and Hayden. 8 points between them. Melandri and Hayden level, of course, in second place, and Edwards currently in fourth, but 8 points adrift of the two Honda youngsters. So we move on further down the grid. We've got, as we said, that full Yamaha second row, Rossi, Edwards and Elias. Third row to Marder, Barros and Checa. And we now move on to the fourth row of the grid with Shinya Nakano. Shinya Nakano, who's signed a new contract with Kawasaki to ride for them in 2006. That was announced this weekend as well. So he will be the teammate to Randy Lepunier. And some people's eyes are a good choice for MotoGP. Some people's eyes are a slightly controversial choice as well, Randy Lepunier.
It's been an interesting choice, isn't it? But of course, it's very important for MotoGP that they have a good French rider in there. We've seen a 17-year-old French rider win the 125cc race here today, so that shows that perhaps the future in France is brighter. But yeah, slightly controversial, but he's been waiting to come into MotoGP for a long time, Randy Lepunier, and it's really this season he's had such a miserable time. Before then, he really, last season, he was a real championship contender up till, what, about three quarters of the way through the season.
Yeah, that's right, and I think, you know, Jeremy Burgess was one of the people who was backing Randy Lepunier's cause to move up to MotoGP. He's had a tough year this season, but it will be very, very interesting to see what Lepunier can do next year. And it's nice to see a factory taking something of a gamble as well, instead of sticking to tried and tested methods where, you know, there's riders out there that, with all respect, are top quality riders, but have proved over the years that they haven't got quite enough to beat Valentino Rossi. And, you know, it's time for factories to start looking towards the future.
Right, well, I think that's what this race is all about in many ways, and I think two of the riders that are going to push Valentino Rossi and the established stars in the future are on the front row of the grid. That's Nicky Hayden, who's qualified third fastest, and Marco Melandri, who's qualified second fastest. I think those two are leading the charge. There's plenty of good youngsters about. I'm standing right next to Tony Elias at the moment. There's another young man, surely, that's going to be there or thereabouts at some sort of stage. And we've seen Casey Stoner in the 250cc race today. Also, you would imagine, along with Danny Pedrosa, the 250cc were world champion, coming into MotoGP. It's a new era. Sometimes we don't like that new era coming in. Certainly some of the old established names don't, but it is time for a change, and it's good to see Kawasaki taking a bit of a punt. And also Suzuki, you've got to say, woman, imagine Chris Vermeulen's going to do very well indeed in MotoGP, but it's a little bit of a gamble. There's a few people about that were talked about the Suzuki ride that were very much established MotoGP stars. They didn't get the ride. They've gone for Chris Vermeulen, and I think that's going to be a very, very interesting combination with him and John Hopkins.
Yeah, and I think Vermeulen's proved the point here this week, and Nicky's out qualified Max Biaggi. So Vermeulen 11th on the grid, Max Biaggi 12th. That's really something to say that Vermeulen can come through and in just, what, two weekends on this bike out-qualify someone with the experience, the world championships and everything else that Max Biaggi's got behind him. It really is quite something. But back on that front row then, in third place, Nicky Hayden. In second place, Marco Melandri, the man who's dominated for much of free practice here. But it's his teammate who starts from pole position, Sete Gibernat. Well, it's my pleasure to say that if you're just joining us, a warm welcome to Turkey for the first time in the history of the MotoGP World Championship. The first ever race at the Istanbul Park Circuit starts with Sete Gibernau on pole position from Marco Melandri and Nicky Hayden on an all Honda front row. It's all Yamahas on row two, Rossi from Edwards and Elias. Row three, Makoto Tomada and Alex Barros on the Hondas, Carlos Checa on the Ducati. Shinya Nakano starts from row four. What a performance from Chris Vermeulen to out-qualify Max Biaggi in just his second MotoGP appearance. Row five, Olivier Jacques from John Hopkins, who's suffering from a bad cold, and Shinichi Ito. Row six, Ruben Chaus, Robbie Rofolk, James Ellison, and then on his own on row seven, it's the Italian veteran Franco Battaini.
Grid now being cleared, as you can probably see, you can certainly hear. That's a Valentino Rossi on the second row of the grid. He all in that shot, he almost looks alongside Sete Gibernau, doesn't he? He's not alongside him, he's right behind him. And how he'd like to try and get past him going into that first bend. Sete Gibernau, what a race for the Spaniard. Can he finally exercise the curse put on him by Valentino Rossi?
Yeah, a chance here to look at that first turn, Nick. It's not such a long drag to turn one. And as you can see now, we're round with Colin Edwards. It goes left. And then it goes right. It's kind of a reverse of the first two turns at Sepang, and it will be a chance for Valentino Rossi. He starts from fourth on the grid, but maybe that could be an even more advantageous position than starting from, say, third where Nicky Hayden is, because if you can get around the outside into turn one, then it gives you a chance of taking the inside line into turn two and really making up some ground.
It was interesting what Davide Brivio said, wasn't it, from Yamaha. He thinks it's going to be like a 125s, like the 250s, a battle between four or five riders. I think he's absolutely right. Let's hope nobody gets away. I think it's quite difficult to get away round here. We could be in for a classic MotoGP race. Glorious sunshine here on the pit wall. Lot of interest, lot of people just cramming every vantage point. It's really very exciting to see MotoGP coming into a new place. And Istanbul certainly is a fantastic venue for MotoGP. And I'm sure MotoGP will put on the show that will show Turkey and show Istanbul what MotoGP is all about. I'm actually standing alongside Tony Elias' father at the moment. God, does he look nervous? Very, very nervous indeed. Of course, he was a former Spanish motocross champion, and I think probably he's guided his son a great deal. But it's Tony Elias' best ever MotoGP start. He's starting from sixth place, second row of the grid on the Yamaha, and his dad looks very nervous. I think I've seen his dad have a cigarette, sly cigarette a few times, but of course out on the pit wall, he's not allowed to do that, is he?
Don't tell Tony Elias' mum.
No, definitely not.
Now, as I said, I think Tony Elias definitely one to watch next season, particularly if he swaps the Honda from Yamaha, as the rumour goes. But even if he were to stay with Yamaha, the progress that he's shown over the last few weeks has really set him out as a name for the future, if he wasn't already. Right there with the Kentucky kid, of course, Nicky Hayden, who will make his way to the front row of the grid here in third place. Really now, the World Championship has been decided, of course, with Valentino Rossi, but the battle is on for second. Nicky Hayden and Marco Melandri level on points in the championship in second place, virtually level on the grid. Both of them will start from the front row. The man lurking behind them is the world champion Valentino Rossi. But the man on pole, we ride with him now, and looking into that first turn is Sete Gibernau.
Welcome to the front row of the grid. 22 laps of this magnificent Istanbul Park Circuit. MotoGP comes to Turkey. What a front row. Sete Gibernau, Marco Melandri and Nicky Hayden. The second row, Colin Edwards and Tony Elias are already here. We're waiting for Valentino Rossi. Valentino Rossi now arrives. The red flag is still being shown. But Turkey stages its first MotoGP race here in the sunshine on the outskirts of Istanbul. The grid is almost here. 22 laps of the Istanbul Park Circuit. Can one of these young pretenders beat Valentino Rossi? We are about to find out.
The first ever Turkish Grand Prix gets underway with Sete Gibernau trailing his foot from the line. Marco Melandri gets a great start from second on the grid. Look at Colin Edwards as well coming through from row two. Edwards looks for the outside line around Gibernau into turn two. Gibernau holds on into second place. Nicky Hayden gets a decent start as well. Valentino Rossi losing the place there to Tony Elias, who's come through. In fact, Valentino Rossi down in about eighth place there, but the race is being led by Marco Melandri.
Yes, Melandri that leads the way. Sete Gibernau, as you say, leg trail, but he's still in second place. But the two Hondas lead the way. Great start by Colin Edwards. Nicky Hayden also there. But Melandri out where he wants to be, out at the front. But Gibernau closing already as they're, what, just a quarter of the way through.
Probably Valentino Rossi's worst start of the season. He's been passed by Makoto Tomada. Here comes Nicky Hayden on the brakes for the first time into this sweeping right-hander ahead of Colin Edwards. Just runs it a little bit wide on the exit. Edwards tries to get back but is unable to do so. So Edwards still down in fourth place.
I would think Nicky Hayden a little bit worried that Marco Melandri is going to get away at the front. Consequently, got past Colin Edwards as quickly as he can. But Melandri leads, Gibernau second, and Hayden in third place. And it's the three Hondas that lead the way.
Three Hondas that started from the front row of the grid. A slight change in the order. We've got Valentino Rossi up to sixth place now. So Barros then now as well on the inside there of Makoto Tomada as well, also making progress. So the top six almost as you were, slightly reshuffled. We've got Marco Melandri, who started from second on the grid. He's passed the pole man, Sete Gibernau, for the lead here. Hayden's where he was in third place. And then a slight reversal in the second row order as well with the three Yamahas of Elias, Edwards and Rossi.
We ride with the race leader, Marco Melandri. Behind him is his teammate, Sete Gibernau, as they go through the left, right and left. That brings it back into the start and finish straight. The end of lap one of this 22-lap race, the Grand Prix of Turkey. And as you say, as it was in the practice, as it was in qualifying, it's a little bit of a turnaround. But it's the Italian Marco Melandri that leads the way.
Melandri leads, Gibernau second. Nicky Hayden backs it into turn one in third place. Colin Edwards fourth. Tony Elias currently lapping in fifth. This is his best ride of the season so far. Valentino Rossi is a distant sixth place here. He's got past Makoto Tomada there to try and catch up with this lead group. But Rossi is really struggling here to make up the gap.
There we are, confirmation of the positions. Matt absolutely spot on. Rossi down in sixth place. Barros seven, Tomada eight. And good ride at the moment by Vermeulen in ninth place.
Signor Nakano 10th from Checker, Jacques, Hopkins, Ito, Biaggi getting a poor start from 12th on the grid. He's down to 15th from Rolfo, Schaus, Elias and Bataini. Ellison, sorry, and Bataini.
Nicky Hayden closing on Sete Gibernau in second place. Meanwhile, Marco Melandri riding a red-hot pace at the front. He has got away. And Nicky Hayden again, I think, realises, as he did with Colin Edwards, he's got to really get past Sete Gibernau because Melandri could disappear into the distance.
Sparks fly from Gibernau's foot peg. Sparks could fly between Gibernau and Hayden very soon because Hayden is closing down on the Spaniard. And as you rightly say, Nick, he knows he's got to get past Gibernau before too long. Rossi will be concerned with this situation as well. He's well adrift there in sixth place and he looks to be struggling.
We ride with Nicky Hayden. The man in front of him is Sete Gibernau under the bridge through this fantastic fifth gear right-hand, 150 miles an hour. Rick it up into six as quick as you can before you're on the brakes as hard as you can any moment. Now look at Melandri on the brakes. Sete Gibernau riding quite defensively, going up the inside, making sure that Hayden has no chance of taking him on the inside, through the left, through the right, then back through the left into the start and finish area. 20 laps to go when they come across the start and finish line.
Nicky Hayden will try and get a run here on Sete Gibernau into this straight. It doesn't look as though he's got it because the first chance to overtake here at Istanbul Park is coming into turn one onto the brakes. As you can see, Marco Melandri with the fastest lap, 154.094. The pace is quick. Rossi is struggling to match it. Now Yamaha, the three Yamaha riders, Edwards, Elias and Rossi. Now we ride with Rossi. Rossi needs to start making his move soon. Here he comes past Tony Elias now as they come into this first left-hander of this sweeping left and right section. First left, then right. down the hill to the bottom and then a tight left-hander.
Well, that's the gap between Marco Melandri in the lead and Valentino Rossi, probably in fifth place, not sixth place now, about 2.5 seconds.
Yeah, Rossi's got his teammate ahead of him, Colin Edwards. That's the battle for fourth place now, and Rossi's going to waste no time here. Well, of course, Colin Edwards, he's battling for second in the championship. He runs it wide there, Colin Edwards, almost as if to let Valentino Rossi through.
It was, wasn't it? So you better come through, you better get up and have a crack at the front. No, sure he didn't, just run it wide. Rossi now up into fourth place. It'll be interesting now to have a look at Rossi's lap times in the next couple of laps, see if he can match the pace of Melandri at the front.
Got no time to hang around here, Valentino Rossi, because this is not as if Marco Melandri is just a flash in the pan. Melandri has been fast and consistent all weekend. They've had two 90-minute sessions as well to get used to this track in both mornings, Friday and Saturday, as well as the usual hour session in the afternoon. So extra time available to check the performance of the bikes on used rubber. That's certainly what Gresini's team have been doing with Givinau and Melandri. Here comes Givinau for the first time, just having a look at the inside of Melandri there again. Oh, Shinichi Ito's been penalised with a jump start there. He's down in 14th place.
Not having a particularly good weekend, is he, poor old Shinichi Ito? He won the Japanese Superbike Championship last week, but not a happy return to MotoGP. But Seto Givinau going very well indeed in second place. Melandri crosses the line in the lead. Givinau second. Hayden third. Rossi in fourth place. And it appears to me that Rossi has set the fastest lap of the race so far.
Certainly has. A 153.749 for Rossi. Shinichi Ito gets a signal to return back to his pit for that jump start. An amazing ride here from Chris Vermeulen, by the way. He's just been relegated to ninth place by Carlos Checa, but he's having a real old battle with Checa there for eighth place in just his second appearance on a MotoGP bike for Honda. And again, you've got to ask the question, what are Honda doing, really, letting Vermeulen slip through their fingers? And it looks like head to Suzuki for 2006.
I bet Paul Denning at Suzuki is looking at two things, John Hopkins and Chris Vermeulen, because he is having a fabulous ride and he's going to be on that Suzuki next year. This is Valentino Rossi, and Rossi now just beginning to make progress in fourth place as he chases after those three Hondas at the front, led by Marco Melandri. Seto Givinau in second place, just a little bit of a gap, then Nicky Hayden. And again, some sparks just coming out of the boot there of Seto Givinau in second place, the left side of his boot, as he digs it into that left-hander.
Here comes Givinau up on the inside, into the tight left-hander. He will take the lead here from his teammate Marco Melandri.
Could this be his day? Well, we've said it so many times this year. I just get the feeling it could be Seto Givinau's day today. He is riding very, very well indeed. Fast right-hander they come through. Now they're onto the brakes. That brings it back in towards the start and finish area. Marco Melandri thinks about going up the inside. Probably a little bit early for that. 18 laps to go when they go across the start and finish line. But Valentino Rossi now putting some real pressure on Nicky Hayden in their battle for third place.
Again, Rossi really can't waste any time here to get past Nicky Hayden, because these two men, as they have been all week, and it's no discredit at all to Nicky Hayden, but Givinau and Melandri have been a class apart this weekend. They've set the pace right from the first practice. Rossi's got to go with them to have a chance here.
What a fabulous sight as those MotoGP machines brake going down the hill for the left-hander, and then they go up round the right-hander. Fabulous stuff. We ride with Marco Melandri in second place. The man in front of him, of course, Seto Givinau. Tyre choice we just had a quick look at, but it's gone off the screen now. And on pit wall, I can't see it.
Medium front, medium rear for both these two riders. In fact, I've got all the tyre choices here in front of me. I can tell you that Valentino Rossi's also got a medium front and medium rear. But Rossi's gone for a medium B as opposed to a medium C. Which I would imagine that the medium C is slightly softer than the medium B that Rossi's got on. So Nicky Hayden also on those mediums. Hayden, in fact, with a medium C as well on the rear. Medium front, medium rear for all of these riders. Although, in fact, there is no other choice, in fact, on the rear. It's no medium. There's no medium soft or hard about it. It's either medium A, medium B, or medium C. So it's varying degrees of softness, really, on the medium rear tyre. Just closing up a little bit there, not perhaps the pace that we might have expected to see from Seto Givinau, having taken the lead. 153.414, but the riders are bunching up together now. That's the gap between Givinau in first place and Rossi in fourth. Let's have a look if that's true now. Rossi, yes, closes down the gap from 1.590 to 1.293. So Hayden and Rossi both taking 0.2 out of the race leader there.
Yeah, in fact, when Melandri was leading the way, it was about 2.4 seconds, wasn't it, at one point, between Melandri was leading and Rossi was in fifth or sixth place then. So the world champion closing the gap on the two Hondas at the front, but he's got to get past Nicky Hayden first before he can have a crack at them. Over the start-finish line they go. Sete Giovinazzi leads the way. Marco Melandri second. Third is Nicky Hayden, and then the Yamaha of Valentino Rossi. They plunge downhill through the shadows, then watch this magnificent shot up through the right-hander over the brow of the hill.
Sete Giovinazzi chasing his first victory of the season. Oh, and he runs it wide, and once again, Sete Giovinazzi out of the lead for the umpteenth time in 2005. He runs it straight into the gravel.
The curse continues. Can you believe it? Under no real pressure, it's still the early stages of the race, and Sete Giovinazzi has made yet another big mistake.
No doubt about it. He's tried to blame other people for it in the past. He's returned to the track, though, this time, Giovinazzi, and there he is, down in sixth place. He's got Edwards and Elias ahead of him. Edwards in fourth place, and Elias with his best ride by far of his MotoGP career so far, currently in fifth.
You can just imagine Valentino Rossi grinning, can't you, behind that visor as he saw that happen.
He won't have been the only one, I don't think.
Well,
there's no love lost between Marco Melandri and Sete Giovinazzi.
No, there's
either.
Not. But there you are. I think it's my curse, not Valentino Rossi's curse on him. I said I thought it might be his day. Right, what can Marco Melandri do? Because it's closing up. There is Sete Giovinazzi battling with Tony Elias, Colin Edwards, but I think any chance he had of winning the race has disappeared. There's Edwards, there's Elias, there is Sete Giovinazzi. Yet another mistake by the Spaniard, but he's going to ride very, very hard. He's got absolutely nothing to lose now, just to go for it. And who knows, we may see an extraordinary ride from Sete Giovinazzi. He's coming up now up the inside of Edwards. He's taking no prisoners anymore now. Let's go for it, he says. And go for it he does. Well done, Sete Giovinazzi. He's got past Elias and he has got past Edwards. Who knows, he might start catching the men at the front again.
3.7 seconds was the gap between Nicky Hayden in third place and Colin Edwards in fourth. So we will have a look now as they come through the split. Melandri leads from Hayden and Rossi. Those three clear at the front. It's 5.8 seconds now, the gap between Rossi in third place and Giovinazzi in fourth. 5.8 seconds, 16 laps to go. It's not beyond the realms of possibility, but Sete Giovinazzi certainly has his work cut out.
Well, you've got to imagine the red mist has come down, haven't you? He's probably just so fed up with everything. You just get the feeling he's just going to go for it, and who knows what that can produce, but Valentino Rossi stalking Nicky Hayden. He's not quite close enough. Marco Melandri would really like to try and take some advantage from this situation, wouldn't he, and try to get away from Nicky Hayden, because you just get the feeling almost inevitably that Rossi will get past Nicky Hayden at some stage. Here comes Sete Giovinazzi. He is opening up a
fair... Carlos Checa as well there. Nick Carlos Checa diving up the inside of Colin Edwards. So Carlos Checa once again continuing his good recent form on the Ducati. His teammate for this weekend, incidentally, Shinichi Ito, as you can see there, has been given the black flag. So he was given a jump start penalty earlier in the race. But Shinichi Ito has decided, obviously, to ignore that. He's got a black flag. He's going to be called in from this race. He would probably receive a suspension from the next race, but I don't think that'll matter to him too much. Although it could provide an interesting situation for Ducati, Nick, because Loris Capirossi is fighting for his fitness for that final round of the season. But it's certainly not clear whether or not he's going to make it back. And, well, that's going to give Ducati something to think about, isn't it?
It is, and, well, I suppose the rules say that Shinichi Ito that is going to be banned, or banned for one race, not Ducati, but others may say, well, just because he's not in the race, they bring another rider, and that's not really the case if Loris Capirossi does ride. But Valentino Rossi now making real inroads into Nicky Hayden, and Nicky Hayden's going to have to work very hard indeed. They cross the line now. There goes Melandri, Hayden and Rossi. 15 laps to go.
7 tenths of a second, the gap between Melandri in first place and Hayden in second. They're a little bit strung out at the moment, but still a long, long way to go. 15 laps, and I'm sure we haven't seen the last of Valentino Rossi in this race. The pace is hot. It's 153.889 from Melandri, 153.857 from Hayden, 153.813 from Rossi, 153.8 dead from Giovinazzi. So Giovinazzi, the fastest rider on the track actually on that last lap, currently down in fourth place, but not really able to make any serious inroads into these three at the front. 5.8 seconds still the gap between Giovinazzi and Rossi. And there is Shinichi to back in pit lane.
I'm just looking at him in pit lane, rather sort of shamefaced, isn't he? Coming into pit lane and being told that that's it. He obviously didn't see the board, I would imagine. He wouldn't deliberately ignore the board. He's a very, very experienced Grand Prix rider as well as a superbike rider. But there we are, black flag. Not a happy day for him. And the bike and Shinichi Ito disappear into the Ducati garage. His race is over.
Well, we've barely had time to catch our breath in this race so far, but time perhaps now to just have a little look at this Istanbul Park Circuit if you've not had a chance to work it out yet. This is the best corner on it, no doubt. That fast right-hander, fifth gear, that's actually turn 11. And now as they come back down to this final section, here's Rossi on the brakes. It's a tight left-hander, first gear. Here he comes into this M section.
Yes, the crowd in the grandstand are on their feet. They're watching it on the big screen. The gentleman standing next to me, the marshal as well, he claps his hands because they all know who Valentino Rossi is now. Rossi going to set after Malandri at the front.
Yeah, they may not have heard of MotoGP in every part of Turkey, but I'm sure they've all heard of Valentino Rossi, and now they're going to find out why he's so famous. He's just set the fastest lap of the race to 153.370. Marco Malandri is pushing hard at the front. 153.463 from Malandri. That's his fastest lap of the race so far. But Rossi is responding. Here's the pass on Nicky Hayden once again. This is for second place. Now the gap between Malandri and Rossi is just over a second, so Rossi knows that he's got to step it up.
Came from quite a long way back, didn't he, Valentino Rossi, on the brakes. He wasn't that close, so it was a brave overtaking manoeuvre, and I think Nicky Hayden was just a little bit surprised by it. Now, can Hayden hang on to the rear wheel of Rossi? That's what he'd be trying to do and get dragged along. But Malandri will know, won't he, that Rossi is in second place and he's on the charge. I think what we do, I've been so enjoying watching the race, I'll have a little walk down pit lane and see what's going on.
Yeah, do your job, Nick. Make a nice change.
You think I was trying to be a commentator, didn't you?
So through this triple apex left-hander, turn 8 then, and once again we'll come down to this wonderfully fast part of the circuit. First of all, it's a tight left-hander. This is turn 9 and 10. It's tight left, then tight right. There's the gap between Malandri and Rossi. It's less than a second now. So Rossi is closing in ever so slightly on this lap, but Malandri has got his sights on his first win. Here's that right-hand turn. It's a fifth gear right-hander, around 230 kilometres an hour, 150 miles an hour. Marco Malandri got such good drive into that turn yesterday on qualifying tyres that he attempted to take it in sixth gear. He said he got into the corner all right, but it was getting out of it was a bit of a problem. So presumably he's still taking that in fifth in the race here. This they'll be taking it in first. It's a tight left, then right. That's where Rossi made the pass on Hayden on the previous lap. Then it's left again. It's almost like an entire M that finishes off this circuit. Then it's back into this straight once again. 720 metres straight, fairly short compared to other Hermann Tilke circuits such as Sepang and Shanghai, of course, the two other circuits designed by the German architect that we go to in MotoGP. He also designed Formula One's Bahrain circuit as well. And all of them fast, furious, but ultimately safe and spectacular. And this, his latest creation, perhaps the best of them all. It really is a wonderful circuit. And you've got to say, if anybody is planning to come and visit a MotoGP race outside of their home country, and they're not from Turkey, of course, then this is a great place to come. It's an ideal location right in between Asia and Europe. And certainly if the attendance here is anything to go by, there should be a few spare seats next year.
Yeah, I think they will be in a fabulous city as well. But just don't worry about the traffic. If you're worried about traffic, don't come. But a magnificent venue, fabulous city, and a really, really... Well, I think a feather in the cap for MotoGP to come to Turkey. I'm just looking at Marco Malandri's pit board at the moment. They're just telling him, although they're waiting obviously him to arrive, that he's got the lead by 0.8 seconds, aren't they? Just going to alter that. Let's have a look.
Yeah, and because he's just stretched it out. And
yeah, he has.
3.
They're putting a 1 there in there now, and they're putting up a 1, and they're putting in a 3, as you so rightly say. So 1.3 for Marco Malandri, and the board when he comes through the start and finish area, that's exactly what he will be told. They're not telling him who it is, but they're changing it
probably,
as I speak.
Probably better that he doesn't know, isn't it?
That's
Nick,
probably that? Right. They're just telling him it's 1 second, actually. That's what they're telling him, just a 1 second.
Yeah, well, it's gone, Nick. The reason for that, it was a single second through the first split. He took out 0.3 from Rossi through the second split, but Rossi's pulled it back through the third split. We'll see what the gap is now as they cross the line, but the Gresini team can offer him no more updated information than that third split, which is a second gap which is maintained over the final split. So Melandri still leads by just a fraction over 1 second. He's pulled out his fastest lap of the race so far. It's a 153.459. Sete Gimenez setting the exact same pace as the three men in the front, but of course, unfortunately for him, he took a trip across one of the corners, and he is now adrift 5.9 seconds down in fourth place. Carlos Checa is currently lapping in fifth place, ahead of Tony Elias in sixth, and Colin Edwards, who's down in seventh. I think Carlos Edwards plays football for Wrexham, doesn't he, Nick?
I think he does, yeah. They lost 2-1 at Bristol Rovers yesterday.
Well, maybe the Edwards family will have something to celebrate before the end of today, but certainly not for Colin Edwards. I don't think seventh place for him, certainly not where he expected to finish, particularly after that good start. He started from fifth on the grid. He had good qualifying pace and, seems to have gone backwards a little bit with his race setting. And it certainly seems as though now the battle for second place in the championship is going to be between two men and two men only. Marco Melandri and Nicky Hayden level on points coming into this round, and separated now by 1.5 seconds. Marco Melandri leading by 1.2 from Valentino Rossi, and then Hayden a further 0.3 back.
I think they're listening to you and the Grassini team, because that's exactly, they're looking at the same splits as you, obviously, but that's what we're going to put on Marco Melandri's board. Just 1.2 seconds is what Marco Melandri is going to be told when he arrives at the start and finish area, chasing, of course, that very, very first Grand Prix victory in the MotoGP class. 125 wins, 250cc wins, a 250cc world championship, but this would be the big one for Marco Melandri. The board being hung out for the Italian. He should arrive any moment now as the helicopter hovers overhead. Here he comes. Marco Melandri leads the Grand Prix of Turkey.
Well, he continues to stretch his advantage out over Valentino Rossi. He's controlling it in much the same way we saw Casey Stoner doing the 250cc race earlier on. There's his teammate Sete Gimenez, 5.6 seconds down now on the men in front of him. So Gimenez closing it down slightly, but it seems that with 11 laps to go, he's not going to get back involved in this battle for the podium. Carlos Checa there in fifth place, Tony Elias, Edwards, Barros in eighth place, Makoto Tomada in ninth, Shinya Nakano currently in tenth, Christopher Mullen riding well in 11th place. But it's Marco Melandri who set the standard all weekend here in Turkey. He really did seem to find a different way around this track to the other riders. It seemed as they were taking a shortcut, didn't it, in first free practice on Friday. He was 0.4 seconds quicker than Sete Gimenez in the first free practice. But Rossi, who was third quickest, was another 0.8 further back. It really was quite phenomenal. And Melandri's just kept that dominance out throughout the weekend. The riders have got closer to him. Sete Gimenez was able to launch a qualifying lap yesterday that was enough for pole position, only just by a fraction of a 0.1 of a second from Marco Melandri. But really, on race tires, Melandri has been a cut above these guys all weekend, and it's no surprise to see him translate that onto the racetrack in the race today here. And you've got to say, Nick, Dani Pedrosa and Nicky Hayden are going to be the two men in the factory supporter team for HRC next year. But they've got to be looking at this guy now, Marco Melandri, in his form over the final section of this championship, and say, could this guy be the man we need to challenge Valentino Rossi in 2006?
Certainly on this form, this is a big, big half a race for Marco Melandri. Yeah, he's looked very good all season. He's very, very strong the sort of quarter part of the season. Had a little bit of a hiccup starting at Laguna Seca in America. He didn't like Laguna Seca. After that, he had a few problems. But he really is back into big form. And he could win this first Grand Prix at the MotoGP level. But Valentino Rossi, we know, will not give up the fight. He will push him all the way. They go through the start and finish area. Sete Gimenez still down in fourth place, but 7.5 seconds now down on Marco Melandri.
Marco Melandri just set the fastest lap of the race so far, a 153.272 from the Italian youngster. He's extended his advantage over Valentino Rossi to more than 1.5 seconds. 1.563 seconds now the gap between Melandri and Rossi. He's really going for it now. Melandri's got his head down. He can taste his first MotoGP victory champagne, and he doesn't want to let it slip.
No, this is going to be a tense time for him, isn't it? Yeah, he can taste it, but the cork hasn't been taken out of the bottle just yet. and Valentino Rossi, as I say, will push him, pressurise him as hard as he can. But Melandri is riding an absolute brilliant race at the front. I think since you've said from the very start, when we're on the start and finish line, although Sete Gibernau was in pole position after that electric qualifying lap, it's been Melandri that has looked consistently fast throughout practice and throughout qualifying. And Nicky Hayden's doing a good job in third place as well, not hanging on to Valentino Rossi, but he's not letting Valentino Rossi disappear out of sight. There we are, just confirmation of that lap, a 1:53.272 for Marco Melandri, chasing his first ever MotoGP victory here at the Istanbul Park Circuit in Turkey. Valentino Rossi in second place, Nicky Hayden in third place, nobody else in sight. Sete Gibernau was there, but yet again, the Spaniard made a mistake into the gravel, dropped him off the pace. He's fighting back, he's in fourth, but he's got no chance of winning this race. That's now all down to his teammate, Marco Melandri.
We ride with Marco Melandri. There were some last-minute changes, it seems, to the front tyres for many of the riders on the grid. They've all gone with a medium front tyre. We saw in the 250cc race that particularly the left-hand side of the tyre had taken a serious amount of stick in this race. And while we were riding with Melandri's front tyre there, and you just wonder how much that could come into play over the final few laps. It's going to be hard work now for Melandri to maintain this lead. He has got a comfortable advantage now of 1.6 seconds. In fact, he's just pulled out a few more tenths through that section, and it's now 1.9 seconds Melandri's gap over Rossi, but Rossi certainly won't give up, and Melandri's got to stay focused over the last nine laps. We ride here with Valentino Rossi, and there is a better view of that circuit with this wonderful GPS system these bikes now use, not to find the way around, of course, but so that we, the viewer, can have a good look at whereabouts they are on the track. It's Rossi in this third gear, triple apex left-hander, turn eight, quite a unique corner. They get on the gas here, the rear end will be lighting up now as they get onto the gas, coming out to that corner there. You can see it's a slight wobble for Rossi's Yamaha, but he keeps it under control, down onto the brakes, into turns 9 and 10, tight left-hander. There's Marco Melandri on the horizon, through the left, then through the right, and then let's hope we can just stay on board with him here. And as they go up through the gears, third, fourth, then fifth gear into this right-hander, stays in fifth, hard on the gas, 250 km an hour, and then soon as you get out of it, up into sixth gear, and as fast as you can down that straight, up to 292 kilometres an hour there for Valentino Rossi. We've seen Carlos Checa clock 306 there during their practice, but 292 for Rossi, onto the brakes again into that left-hander. He goes left, right, left again, and then into this start-finish straight. What is the gap now as they cross the line between Melandri and Rossi?
Well, Melandri has just crossed the line. Here goes Rossi, 1.652 seconds. So he's holding it pretty stable, isn't he, Marco Melandri? If it remains the same, if he can keep this sort of gap between him and the world champion, he, of course, will win his first MotoGP race. And Rossi, you're going to say, he's not struggling, but he's having to work very, very hard to keep Melandri in any sort of sight. But Nicky Hayden in third place, also working hard to keep Rossi in sight. So not perhaps the race we expected it to be, very, very close. But if we get a new Grand Prix winner and it's Marco Melandri, I think everybody will be delighted. Perhaps not at Yamaha, but everywhere else. It's a lad that won a 125cc race when he was just 15 years old. 250cc world champion. He came into MotoGP riding at Yamaha. Had a lot of really serious injuries in his first season. Never really materialised riding the Yamaha. He went to the Gresini Honda team. They've really treated him like a son. And he's borne fruit, hasn't it? He's lying second in the world championship at the moment with Nicky Hayden. He's on the verge of bringing the Telefonica movie star Honda team their first win of the season. Probably even more important to Marco Melandri, winning his first ever MotoGP race.
Nicky Hayden's not given up the ghost just yet. He's in third place, but he's set his fastest lap of the race so far with eight laps to go. 1:53.386 from Hayden. Just pulling a fraction of a tenth back on Valentino Rossi. Not really making an impression there on the Italian. This is further down. We've got Sete Gibernau on his own in fourth place. 8.2 seconds down, though, on Nicky Hayden. Then it's Carlos Checa, sorry, in fifth place. Then this is the battle for sticks between Colin Edwards, Alex Barros. Makoto Tomada is at the back of that pack. Antonio Elias now has dropped down to ninth place.
Slightly disappointing there for Tony Elias, wasn't it? Because he was right up there, but just dropping down to ninth. But finishing the top ten, it won't be so bad. But I would say he'd be disappointed at the end of the race.
I think Colin Edwards will be very disappointed at the end of the race because his chances of finishing second in the championship here are going to be all but gone. If Marco Melandri wins this race, then it's going to be a 9-point difference between Melandri and Hayden in the championship. But with Edwards already 8 points before the start of 8 points behind before the start of play here today, then he will be something like 21 points back going into that final round in Valencia in 2 weeks' time.
I'm back with the Telefonica Movie Star Honda team, very calm on pit wall at the moment. I'm telling Marco Melandri he's got a lead of 1.8 seconds. I don't think they can hardly believe it. They've waited a long, long time. It's been a desperate season for them. Marco Melandri really has been the bright spark for them. But with the coming into the penultimate round, round 16 of the championship, would you believe they could be winning their first race? But there's still some vital laps to go for number 33.
Well, he certainly knows what it's like to win races, Marco Melandri. He's done it often enough in the 250cc and 125 classes. He won 10 250cc races over the three seasons that it took him to win the World Championship, and seven in the 125s as well. So 17 Grand Prix victories altogether, but none of them will quite match up to this one if he can keep this going now over the final six and a half laps.
Nervy time for everybody involved, isn't it? Six and a half laps to go for Marco Melandri. That's the gap between him and Valentino Rossi. We're actually now in the Repsol Honda pit, and they're obviously following the progress of their man, Nicky Hayden, in third place. Again, a very, very good performance by Nicky Hayden. Consistent podium finishes now for the American, but all eyes are focused on that white number 33 on that blue machine. You can feel the tension in the pit, can't you, as he flashes through the start and finish area once again.
Oh, look at that, fastest lap of the race so far from Marco Melandri, 153.267. he's going for it again. He's making his second charge for the line here. Six laps to go. Marco Melandri is trying to escape from Valentino Rossi. Nicky Hayden has taken 0.3 of a second out of Rossi on that last lap. Rossi with a 153.620, Hayden 153.270, so nearly 0.4 of a second, in fact, there in favour of Nicky Hayden. So Hayden now pushing to finish second in this race and limit the damage here in the chase for second in the championship.
What a performance that would be for Honda, wouldn't it? They can relegate Valentino Rossi down to third place. That's the gap. Marco Melandri riding an absolutely superb race. This is Nicky Hayden in third place at the moment. He's chasing after the world champion, Valentino Rossi, who's in second place. And well, Hayden, what his third second would be his third consecutive podium finish.
Yeah, he's never done that before, Nicky Hayden. His rider suit is staying nice and cool there. That Alpine Star's 24.2 degrees. I'm not sure what the Earl Hayden, his father's rider suit, is down there. I think
his temperature is about 857, I think, Earl, at the moment.
Yeah, I think his jocks might be a little bit more sweaty than Nicky's at the moment. But definitely Marco Melandri here.
We heard that, actually, so I would be quiet now.
Marco Melandri then leading this race and leading the charge for second in the championship. It's almost like a championship within a championship. We were hearing from Marco Melandri and Nicky Hayden in the press conference yesterday for the front row. And Marco said, it's like we've got a two-round championship. We start from zero and two rounds here. Istanbul this weekend and Valencia next weekend from me and Nicky. And, well, they've emerged as the two serious contenders to Valentino Rossi's dominance of MotoGP in the second half of this season. They've been consistent ever since Motegi, really, when Melandri was taken out by Valentino Rossi in the race. But Hayden and Melandri, no doubt about it, the two future stars of MotoGP. And, you know, you look at Yamaha, Nick, of course, they've got the cream of MotoGP riding for them at the moment, Valentino Rossi. But both Marco Melandri and Nicky Hayden could have both ended up riding for Yamaha. You may remember a lawsuit with involving Nicky Hayden when he first moved to MotoGP. Lynn Jarvis and Yamaha thought they had him signed up, but he eventually went to Honda and stuck with the factory that took him to the AMA Superbike title. And that didn't go down too well at Yamaha. And then, of course, Marco Melandri, who had two really difficult years at Yamaha in MotoGP. Perhaps some people thought that he wasn't looked after properly by the team or the factory. They allowed him to slip away to Honda. And now look at him, absolutely flying here with a 2.6 second advantage over the world champion and on course for his first MotoGP victory.
I remember him winning that 125cc race in Assen. He was just 15 years old at the time, and here we are, he's progressed all the way through. I think you're absolutely right. We're looking at the three riders, obviously Valentino Rossi, the world champion, the man that's dominated so far, but the two young pretenders, they're riding quite brilliant. I'm going to have a quick word though with Carlo Fiorani. He's just gone a little bit quieter on pit lane. Great ride by Marco Melandri at the front. Nicky's doing well. Two young riders that really are progressing.
Yeah, they are the future for Honda. So I'm very happy for Marco and for Niki because they show their ability and especially both, for both. They are showing to everybody their skills. And so we are happy. So they are our hopes for next year.
And Marco Melandri, he deserves a Grand Prix win.
Yeah, absolutely. And I hope that, I mean, of course, I work for a Repsol Honda team, so I hope for Niki, but I'm Italian, so I will be happy if Marco wins.
Carlo, thank you.
Welcome.
Carlo Ferrari, there.
Mixed blessings there.
Yeah, team manager for Repsol Honda and sporting director for Honda Europe. He's going to be moving up in Honda next year as well, so the story goes. So it'll be a nice way for Carlo Fiorani to sign off from MotoGP. But Marco Melandri has been getting quicker as this race has gone on. In the previous lap, while we were talking to Carlo Fiorani there, a 153.111, sensational lap from Marco Melandri. Here comes Tony Elias, who's giving a real fight to Alex Barros over the final few laps as well. That's a battle for seventh place. Carl Colin Edwards is currently lapping in sixth. We ride there with Alex Barros. That's the youngster in front of him as well. We heard from Carlo Fiorani there saying that Marco Melandri and Niki Hayden are the future of Honda, but Tony Elias will be one of them as well. It looks certain that he's going to be joining Marco Melandri with Fortuna sponsorship at Team Gresini in 2006. Alex Barros, we're not too sure where he's going, but Nick, lots of other pieces falling into place this weekend.
Yeah, they certainly have. Just look what we've got. Kawasaki sorted. Nakano and Randy Depruniere. Suzuki not officially announced, but sorted, isn't it? It's going to be John Hopkins and Christopher Mullin. As you say, Gresini, one would imagine it's signed and sealed. Just about to be announced. That's going to be Melandri and Tony Elias. Yamaha, a little bit vague about their third machine. Could be Casey Stoner. How interesting that would be after the way he rode to win a fabulous 250cc race this afternoon. But it is all taking shape. And we do get the prophets of doom about MotoGP, but there are some absolute cracking youngsters coming through, and they're gradually replacing the old brigade. And the man leading this race is leading the charge of the youngster. The man in third place also is right up there with him. Hayden and Melandri really have come of age this season, and it would just be so good to see Melandri win a Grand Prix, like Niki Hayden did, of course, at Laguna Seca in America.
Christopher Mullin fans will be pleased to know that their rider is currently in 11th place, and he's holding off a former world champion and an experienced Honda rider in the shape of Max Biaggi. The Mullin in 11th place. Biaggi's miserable season continues. He's down in 12th. Lovely stuff from Marco Melandri now. He looks to be enjoying himself, doesn't he, as he has done all weekend, sliding that Honda around. He's got an advantage of almost 3 seconds now over Valentino Rossi. He's got 3 laps to go. It's in his hands. He can only lose it now, Marco Melandri. Now then, we ride here with Alex Barros once again. He's coming under pressure now from Makoto Tomada. Tony Elias has already passed the Brazilian, who's really been struggling with his left sider. He had a big crash in the race at Phillip Island 7 days ago. He was really beaten up quite badly, particularly on his left side. This, of course, being an anti-clockwise circuit, works the left-hand side a lot harder than the right. And I just wonder now, at this stage of the race, if Alex Barros is starting to feel that.
That was a very, very big accident indeed in Phillip Island. We all went home on the plane on a Monday afternoon, and there was a photograph on the back page of the national newspaper in Australia of his crash, and it just made everybody take their breath in. It was a spectacular photograph and a horrendous looking accident. On the very first lap here at Istanbul, he went out on the very first lap, Alex Barros, and disappeared into the gravel at the end of the first lap, and he must have really been worried that he was going to fall once again. He hung onto the bike, he didn't go down, but he really was bashed about. That was a high-speed accident, the sort of accident that we saw that injured Kenny Roberts and, of course, Loris Caparossi.
It looks as though we've covered all the MotoGP riders for next year, but the one team left there really is, not sure what's happening with Konica Minolta Honda and Makoto Tomada. They could continue next year. Bit of a question mark there, but it seems as though that Sito Pons team is going to be Max Biaggi and Carlos Checa, so Alex Barros could find himself out of the door there. And we're, of course, still waiting news on Sete Givinov's potential move to Ducati to join Loris Capirossi. But everything, it seems, falling into place now after a confusing, silly season ever since Bruno, really. But one thing that is for certain here is Makoto Tomada eventually does pass Alex Barros. One thing for certain here today is that with 2 laps to go, a 3-second advantage at the front, Marco Melandri is surely going to win his first ever MotoGP race.
Well, we could be talking about this day in a couple of years' time, perhaps when he wins the World Championship. Very, very close to winning the World 125cc Championship. He won the 250cc Championship. He came into MotoGP. taking him a little time to mature, but mature he has, and he is riding an absolutely brilliant race at the front there. I just wonder how he's feeling now. As you say, he's the sort of guy that would be out there just enjoying himself, but he must be just a little bit nervous. What, with a lap and a half to go, I tell you, there's going to be mighty, mighty relief here on pit wall for the Telefonica Movistar Honda team. You wouldn't have believed at the start of the season it would be their first victory of the year. What can you say about Sete Gimeno? There he was, right in there, battling for the lead, and then he ran off the track and he's going to finish fourth and out of the podium positions once again. And a very, very good ride again by Nicky Hayden. Valentino Rossi, I think he's tried all he's known to stay with Marco Landry. It's just not his or Yamaha's day. Surely the day is going to belong to Italy, but not this Italian, but the young pretender to his throne, Marco Melandri.
6 weeks ago, Marco Melandri was sat in the Clinica Mobile having 38 stitches put into his injured foot. He bounced back 1 week later to finish fifth in the Malaysian Grand Prix at Sepang. He went on then to go from fifth on the grid to take second at Qatar, his best ever MotoGP finish. He went from eighth on the grid to take fourth at Phillip Island last weekend. But this now, surely, the final lap of Marco Melandri's greatest moment.
Yeah, I'm walking up pit lane now. I'm at the back of the Telefonica Movistar Honda pit wall. Very, very calm indeed. Fausto Grassini, he's seen it all before. He's won Grand Prix, he's won World Championship. They're now asking everybody to come out of the garage and come up to pit wall to celebrate, we hope, and they hope, with Marco Melandri. But they've seen it all before, haven't they, with Sete Gimeno? They've seen it with Sete when he's been leading races. They saw it in Jerez when he was leading the race, going to the last bend. Some people, I can tell you now, are not looking at the screens. They're just turning away, and they're just waiting for this big, big moment. Fausto Grassini himself looks very, very nervous. Who can blame him? But surely Marco Melandri is going to rewrite the history books and win his first ever MotoGP race.
Tense times at Yamaha there as well. A close battle between Colin Edwards and Tony Elias for sixth place. We've got Melandri out on his own in the front, with Rossi and Hayden currently in line for those podium finishes. Gimeno on his own in fourth place from Checa, also on his own in fifth. And it's Edwards, Elias, Tomada, Barros and Nakano. Marco Melandri looks over his shoulder. He will now come into this wonderful right-hand bend for the final time here in the inaugural Grand Prix of Turkey. Just four more corners to go for Marco Melandri as he heads down one last time into this M section. He's got a 3 second advantage over his great friend, his former pocket bike rival and current MotoGP world champion Valentino Rossi. They go left, they flick it right. One more bend to go for Marco Melandri, who becomes the winner of the first ever Turkish Grand Prix. Marco Melandri is a MotoGP winner at last, the winner of the Grand Prix of Turkey. Valentino Rossi takes second place, and Nicky Hayden, back-to-back podiums, three in a row for the American for the first time in his career.
They are going completely berserk here on pit wall, I can assure you. It's been a very, very long, hard season for them. Some people are in tears. Yep, there are people in tears, I can assure you. At last, they've broken the duck at the penultimate race of the season. But probably even more important, the race has been won by Marco Melandri. Marco Melandri wins his first MotoGP race. And I can tell you, Telefonica Movistar Honda are celebrating, and they are celebrating in style. Now I've got to try and find an English-speaking person just to tell you what it's all about. That is not easy with the team, to be honest with you, but we'll see what we can do.
Oh, I'm sure they'll all be speaking English tonight.
Mike, Carlo Molina's here. I know he can speak English. Carlo, you've done it. Congratulations. What a ride by Marco.
I'm very happy for Mark, you know, for what he did for the team. We must be grateful for Honda, what they did for us. It's a great success. Very, really very happy for this end of the season.
It's been such a long, hard year for you, isn't it?
It deserves. I think we've been working very well for all the week, and that's what we deserve for sure.
And finally, that's the first of many, surely, for Marco Melandri.
Yeah, that's good for now for him, keeping him for next season. So, very happy.
I can tell you, Carlo is shaking here with emotion. He's so, so pleased. It's fantastic.
We cannot hide it, because that's first win for Marco, first win for the team this season. So we'll be struggling a lot to for this achievement, and now it's time to enjoy it.
go and enjoy it, and thank you for talking to us.
Thanks, Nick.
Carlo Malini there, the PR man for Team Gresini, and the sole English, the sole Anglophone.
I think he is. I think he was shaking. It was like somebody who had the flu, to be honest with you. What a fantastic performance by Marco Melandri, and that's such great news, I think, for them, for Honda, but I think even more important, I think, for MotoGP. We've got another Grand Prix winner, and this guy is going to push Valentino Rossi to the limit. And when Valentino Rossi finally disappears, perhaps we found the man that's going to win the World Championship.
And Valentino Rossi is not the only man who can perform rolling burnouts, a one-footed wheelie, and then stand on the seat and do a one-footed wheelie.
I tell you, I just got to go. Seto Gibernau is coming to the pits fast. He has just pushed, just left his bike, and he's just stormed through the back of the pits. On one side of the garage, they're celebrating. And the other side, I'm sure the rev limiter wasn't on. He raced into the pits, nearly took two or three people out, jumped off the bike, and just ran and just disappeared. He is absolutely furious.
Quite pathetic behaviour then once again, really, isn't it? Because this was entirely his fault, as so often of his mistakes have been this season. Gibernau has seemingly found somebody else to blame every time. But there's only so much the team can take, and Gibernau, quite honestly, is responsible for what has been a disastrous season for him. And it looks as though he'll be riding for Ducati next season, and we'll see if his luck changes. But another mistake from Seto Gibernau here, and he's once again let potential victory slip through his hands, and it couldn't have landed in the lap of a better person. Marco Melandri taking his first ever Grand Prix victory, MotoGP victory, to add to 17 wins in the 250cc and 125 classes. There is that front tyre of Marco Melandri. I'm sure there's not much rubber left on it. There can't be hardly anything left on the rear after that rolling burnout. And there's going to be a party tonight in Turkey, you can guarantee that. What a ride from Tony Elias, by the way. Pipped Colin Edwards to sixth place on the line. He got a tow off Edwards for his qualifying position yesterday. And I was up there in the Yamaha box when Elias came in all smiles and said, thank you very much to Colin Edwards. And I think the pleasantries will be quite so nice this time. This is the move from Elias on the inside of Edwards. Sounds like you're down there by Parc Fermé, Nick.
I cannot see a thing. Marco Melandri is just, I had to let you hear, he has just completed the biggest rear tire burnout you have ever seen. He is just so pleased. Everybody's pleased with him. All the people from Repsol Honda have also come over. Saw Davide Brivio from Yamaha come over and shake hands over Fausto Gresini. Well done, Marco Melandri. Just fantastic. He's just running towards the team. Oh, he's fallen over. I don't know if you can see it on the screen. He's fallen over the barriers, actually, into the crowd. He's not in Parc Fermé anymore. He's disappeared. Well done. And as we spoke to Carlo Malini there, the marketing manager for the team, he was shaking with emotion. They're so pleased. Great day for MotoGP. Valentino Rossi just a little bit quiet alongside him, but still a smile from Valentino Rossi. He's done all the hard work, hasn't he? And I think if he was going to lose a race, perhaps losing it to Marco Melandri would please him more than losing it to some other people, certainly Seto Gibernau or Max Biaggi.
His physical trainer there as well. They've worked hard together over the winter, first of all, to get Marco Melandri in tip-top condition, and then particularly over the last few weeks after that nasty crash at Motegi with Valentino Rossi when he was spiked by his foot peg, remember, 38 stitches he rode with there in Sepang the week after that to finish fifth in the race, but nothing could have topped this performance from the youngster. He's beaten the master, fair and square, no doubt about it. Rossi wanted to win this race. He would have equaled Mick Doohan's record of 12 wins in a season. He's got one more race to do it, of course, in Valencia. But this defeat here to Marco Melandri means that he will not beat Doohan's record by taking 13 wins by the end of the year.
Let's have a quick word with Nicky Hayden.
You know, all week I knew it was going to be hard work today, but I just, got to start and just went with them as long and as hard as I could. And, we just didn't have that pace. I mean, they were going so fast up front. I mean, it was almost, so much quicker than I went all week. But I rode my hardest and tried to stay in there. And I got bucked by the lapper. And once Valentino got away from me, I hang on. And we go to Valencia. We're still shot at it. And we won't give up till the last round. So we keep fighting. But congratulations to Marco. He definitely earned it really fast today.
And did he try and hang on to Valentino then, did you? Just wanted to...
Yeah, no, I hung on to him. I had a few spots on the track that was faster, and then there was two spots where I was just getting killed, and I couldn't make it up. And was just riding on the razor edge, and you know, we just solid ride after I felt, you know, I knew it was going to be hard work, but you know, I'm not happy with third, especially Marco really pulled it out on the points. But like I said, we won't give up. We keep fighting. Thanks to the team for a good bike, and we still get another crack at them next week.
Sure do.
And there was Nicky Hayden for you, Matthew, and I think disappointed, but still pleased. He's put in some really consistent podium finishes now, and that was another good performance by Nicky Hayden. But the day belongs to Marco Melandro. I don't think there's any doubt about that, and what a performance by the Italian. We'll try and have a word with him, but he's a... Valentino Rossi now and Marco Melandri just embrace each other, and I think Rossi knows just the day perhaps he's a fallen second best to Marco Melandri. We're trying to have a word with him in a minute, or listening to somebody having a word with him. He's just doing some stuff for Italian television, and a big shake of the hand from Nicky Hayden as well. Congratulations to Marco Melandri. Let's just see if we can get a word with him in a sec.
Well, we'll wait to hear hopefully from Marco Melandri then. Down there in Parc Fermé, there's the embrace between Rossi and Melandri, and well deserved as well. Melandri there looks about to speak to Spanish TV, but well, it's the start of a new era really in many ways in MotoGP. Valentino Rossi, of course, will still be around next year, but we've got a glimpse of the future this season. We've seen wins for Nicky Hayden and now Marco Melandri.
We just kind of a quick word, I think, with Valentino Rossi now, if you want to have a listen in, Matt.
Valentino, it wasn't to be a 12th victory of the season, but I'm sure you're happy for Marco as well.
Yes, yes, for sure. For Marco today was a great ride. He did an incredible race. He didn't make mistakes, so I'm happy for him. And for me, the weekend was difficult. A lot of problems. We worked very well with the team. We tried to make an incredible setting for today. This morning work, also this afternoon was not so bad, but when the tires start to slide, I was a bit in difficult. Marco in some point are faster than me. But anyway, second place is not so bad. I try, but we try for the next time.
Yeah, second is...
Oh, quick word there with Valentino Rossi, and I think just saying that he had to settle for that second place in the end to Marco Melandri. Marco Melandri about to make his way from Parc Fermé, make his way up towards the podium for the very, very first time. He'll be on that top step of a MotoGP podium. We might just get a very, very quick word with him. At the moment, he's talking to Randy Mamola, and here we are. Let's have a word with Marco Melandri.
Marco, you must have known when this weekend began after that first practice that this was your best chance of a win.
Yeah, I had so good feeling with this track, with the bike and with the tyres since Friday morning. So I'm so happy, and to lose the pole position yesterday, it's been so good for me because I learned that I have to take the race just for fun and to not think about the result. When I saw Sete made a mistake, I tried to do my lap time, my rhythm, and try to be concentrated to do so good all the time, and I cannot explain my emotion at all.
I bet you can't.
Okay, can't explain his emotions, Marco Melandri. I think there'll be plenty of emotions explained a little bit later on when the parties start and when he's up there on the rostrum. Well, what a fabulous day we've had in Turkey. Perhaps not the closest MotoGP race we've seen of the season, but we've got a new Grand Prix winner in the MotoGP class. It's Marco Melandri. Valentino Rossi giving it absolutely everything he can to finish in second place. And Nicky Hayden continuing with those podium finishes on the Repsol Honda. But it's Marco Melandri now that could finish second in the World Championship to Valentino Rossi as the riders disappear from view and onto that podium. And for the first time, as I say, on that very top step, we will see Marco Melandri.
Well, it's been quite a weekend, hasn't it, here in Turkey, the first trip that we've had here, and it's been eventful from the word go. Ever since we landed and had to fight our way through the traffic there in Istanbul, it's been non-stop action all the way, and certainly here on the track at the Istanbul Park Circuit, we've not been let down whatsoever in any of the three classes. Fantastic races in the 125s, 250s and MotoGP. Drama all the way. And it's ended really, in many people's eyes, I'm sure, in the best possible way with a very, very deserved winner of the MotoGP race. He's had his troubles this year, Marco Melandri, but he's shown what a good, strong rider he is, what a strong character he is, and he's pulled out some performance out of the bag today.
Certainly has, and I think it's just good for MotoGP. We've seen Nicky Hayden win a race this year. We've now seen Marco Melandri win a race this year. Obviously, Loris Caparossi and Alex Barros have won races previously. Nobody's going to touch Valentino Rossi at the moment. But the future of MotoGP is in very, very good hands. Very capable hands. Nicky Hayden in third place. But the most capable hands at the moment, Marco Melandri, the 250cc former world champion, on the top step for the first time in MotoGP here in the Turkish sunshine. It's a day he's not going to forget in a hurry.
There is his physical trainer. I only know him by his nickname, which is Buzz. He unfortunately couldn't tell you his full name, but I can tell you he's one heck of a football player. We played against him at Mugello in a friendly match between the English and the Italian journalists, and he was a bit quick, wasn't he, Nick?
It was certainly too quick for me, that's no doubt at all. Here comes Nicky Hayden.
Nicky Hayden back on the podium, his third consecutive podium. That's the first time he's managed that in MotoGP. So a good consistent finish to the year for Nicky Hayden, even if it's not going to be enough for second in the championship. 11 points now he trails Marco Melandri with one round remaining. Valentino Rossi up to second place, but it's probably the most pleasing second place of his career. Marco Melandri makes an entrance onto the top step. It's his first time in MotoGP. What a win for the youngster from Ravenna. Well, he likes to DJ in his spare time, Marco Melandri. I'm sure he'll be spinning the tracks at his home party when he heads back, probably to England, and maybe a time for a trip to Italy as well before that final round of the season in Valencia. Another consistent and solid performance from Nicky Hayden. He's been racking in the points in this second half of the championship and really laying a solid base for 2006.
Sort of trophy you want to keep when you won your first MotoGP race as well, isn't it? Valentino Rossi gets his trophy for second place, but you just look at this trophy that Marco Melandri is going to receive for winning the Grand Prix of Turkey here at Istanbul Park. It's a trophy he will keep and he will remember forever. What a fabulous trophy. What a fabulous ride by Marco Melandri. Marco Melandri wins his first MotoGP Grand Prix here in Turkey at the penultimate round of the 2005 World Championship.
Macho, the Hedgehog, the DJ Jowry, he's got many names, Marco Melandri, and he can add to that list. Grand Prix winner, MotoGP winner, 250cc world champion as well. He's quite a talent, Marco Melandri, and I'm sure we're going to be seeing plenty more of him on the rostrum next year. And once again, this time it's for a different rider, but the Italian national anthem rings out over the MotoGP paddock. Moment for Marco Melandri. He's kissing anything that moves, his Michelin cap, his helmet, his trophy, his everything, and I'm sure there'll be plenty more of that going around tonight. Maybe one lucky Turkish girl will be on the receiving end of a few as well, you never know.
It's a day he's not going to forget, as he's chatting away to Nicky Hayden on the podium. Nicky Hayden thinking probably, well, I've had a good day, but I would rather be in the situation. Here comes the champagne. Valentino Rossi's got, he knows better than anybody. He's got the bottle open quicker than anybody else. But now the champagne flows. It flows for Honda, and it flows for Marco Melandri here in Turkey.
Well, they grew up together on the mini bike tracks of Italy, and here they stand together on the top of the MotoGP podium, the pinnacle of motorcycle racing. And the two riders now who are at the very top of the tree. Already crowned MotoGP world champion is Valentino Rossi on the left of your picture. And there, Marco Melandri, who now looks in pole position now to seal second in the championship. 11 points the gap now, remember, between Melandri and Nicky Hayden. One round to go. That's at Valencia in 2 weeks' time.
Yeah, it's not a day we're going to forget, I don't think. I think it's a day that in commentaries in two, three, even a year's time, we're going to say, yeah, we remember the day that he won that first MotoGP race, because he's going to win a lot more, and he really has got the potential to be the new MotoGP world champion. He may even give Valentino Rossi a bit of a hard time next season, and that really would be fantastic for the championship if he could do that.